higher education in the digital era. There are tips, opportunities, challenges, and direction. And as introduced, I am Dr. Melinda De La Peña Bandalaria, Chancellor and Professor at the University of the Philippines Open University. So what are the imperatives for higher education transformation, especially in this era of digitization? So the first is there is a need for us to be agile and flexible so that we will be able to face the various disruptions affecting the continuity of the learning processes. So as we know, many schools were closed because of the COVID-19 pandemic. And this data from July 2020 estimated 23.8 million students not being able to return to educational institutions because of the COVID-19 pandemic. Most affected were the students from the South and West Asia and those coming from the tertiary education sector, with an estimate of about 3.5% students not being able to go back to school because of the pandemic. Also, in March 2021, it was also the numbers that were obtained, 682 million students living in countries with closed schools. There were schools that were partially open, but still with limitations. But there are also educational institutions which were forced to close operations because they were not able to adapt or to be able to address the challenges required because of this shift to online or remote instruction. But of course, it's not just the pandemic that we should worry about when it comes to the disruption in education. We should also worry about the natural disasters. So we have a volcanic eruption, just like the case in the Philippines, typhoons, floods. Of course, we also experience disruptions in the peace and order situation, which is also happening in many parts of the world. Of course, we know and we have experienced this, that the current education system, the kind of education system, the pre-COVID-19, which assumes a physical presence of teachers and students at the same time in a space, in a specified space, is not agile or flexible, and it's not inclusive. This kind of illustration by Laurentius de Voltolina, a 14th century illustration, is something that we can still witness in the present day classroom. So generally speaking, schools have looked the same for the last 75 years or more. The second imperative is the Paris message, which projected that more than 400 million students would be needing higher education by 2030. So therefore, there is that need, urgent need, to respond to the scale of this demand for accessible, affordable, and quality education. There is also the Education Agenda 2030. We are all familiar with this, which need to ensure inclusive and quality education and promote lifelong learning opportunities for all by 2030. We should also be providing learning opportunities for out-of-school youth. So this is a data from the Philippines that out of 100 students who started grade one at the basic education level, only 14 of them would be able to complete tertiary education. 29 would be dropping out at the tertiary education level. So what there is a need for us that even if they are not part of the formal education system, there has to be something that we should be providing for them in terms of learning. Of course, there is this imperative for us to respond to the need of the fourth industrial revolution. We are aware of this skills mismatch or gap between what the employers demand and what we at the education sector are providing. And of course, it was also projected that 7 out of 10 of our workers are in jobs which are in danger of being removed or no longer relevant because of the fourth industrial revolution. And as we continue to talk about responding to the fourth industrial revolution, there are now talks about IR 5.0 or the fifth industrial revolution, which is the return of the human hands and minds in the industrial framework. And again, the tertiary education institutions have a role to play when it comes to training these individuals who will be manning the industry of the IR 5.0. The sixth imperative is the rise in the gig of the gig economy. So gig economy is the new normal in the workplace. So it is a phenomenon defined by a rise in independent or contracted work. And in the Asia-Pacific region alone, 84% of hiring managers outsource to gig workers. So in order for these gig workers to be to continuously be relevant in the market, we need to provide also learning opportunities, gig learning opportunities for them. And the seventh imperative is the university social responsibility, or the need for us to contribute to the achievement of the sustainable development goals, considering or keeping in mind that education is at the center of each of these SDGs. And of course, we are all aware at the university level that there is also this university impact ranking. And I'm sure many, if not all of us, are aspiring to be part of this university impact ranking by the Times Higher Education. The other imperative is this challenge for us that many of today's school children will work in new job types that do not yet exist, most of which are likely to have an increased premium on both digital and social emotional skills. They will be working with peers, collaborating with peers, residing in various parts of the world, and they need to understand the cultural nuances and, in many cases, use digital tools to enable these new types of interaction. Now, the question is, are we preparing our learners for this future world of life and work? Now, for the opportunities, of course, there are many which was offered as a result of our experience during this COVID-19 pandemic, the capability building programs that we participated in, the lessons, insights brought about by our experience, the national and institutional policies and infrastructure that were put in place so that we can ensure that learning would continue even during this time of COVID-19 pandemic. There is also this UNESCO OER recommendations which was adopted by 193 countries and or member states, and discovered five recommendations from policies up to development of inclusive, quality, open educational resources. And this will support many open education initiatives, which the tertiary higher education institutions can take advantage of if they really want to transform themselves during this time of the digital era. And of course, digitization offers more opportunities for the integration of the universal design for learning so that we can really have more or offer more inclusive learning opportunities. Now for the challenges, of course, we are aware that digital exclusion is still a big challenge. Also because of the uneven development of information and communications technologies across the country and even across the region. There is also this still the dominance of the intellectual property right mindset among our experts, which prevent them from sharing the work, the works that they do, and also the low awareness and adoption of open educational resources and other forms of open education. As we have observed also, there's still the slow adoption of the universal design for learning features in various modes of delivering instruction. There is also this question that is a challenge for us. Will we return to traditional passive learning in front of a whiteboard or move to a new path, focus on student well-being and reducing the deep inequalities of global learning? And this, there is this call from UNESCO that we must work together to make our education systems more resilient and better prepared for the current paradigm shift, as well as to face the possible crisis in the future. So what is the direction that we hope to move towards to? So as we transform the higher education in this digital era, we are also hoping for the sustainable higher education system, characterized by these features, agility, flexibility, inclusion, quality education, and of course, relevant or pluridisciplinary opportunities for learning. And this is what we hope to see in the configuration of the University of the Future. So again, thank you very much for this opportunity, and good day to everyone.
Thank you very much, Professor Bandalarir, for your excellent presentation. And I think we can have three takeaways. One is that she has reiterated that the multiple disruptions is not only the pandemic. There are so many needs that university needs to transform. This is including, you know, natural disaster, you know, the calls for the SDGs, the Paris message, also the education agenda 2030s. Second takeaway is that digital transformation and digitization can be seen as an opportunity, but it's also come with the challenges. Digital divide is one of the challenges that we have to face, and we have to figure it out how to deal with it. The third takeaway is that the higher education needs to be transformed into a more sustainable higher education system. And with that, we have to think about how do we make our system more agile, flexible, inclusive, ensure quality, and stay relevant to our learners and our sustainable societies. So with that, now we have seen a big broad picture, which very well set the frame for our further discussion. Next, we'll move on to listen to the good practice by the universities for their responses to the COVID-19. So today we are very honored to have with us, and I would like to introduce to you Associate Professor Dr. Somporn Puttaphithakpon. She is the Acting Vice President and the Director of the Documentation and Information of Sukhothai Thammathirat Open University. Dr. Somporn is renowned for her pioneering work in information management, both academically and in practice. She has written many textbooks and papers on information management. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Somporn. So she will also show her pre-recorded video. So please.
Hello, I would like to bring to your attention the experience at SPOU or Sukhothai Thammathirat Open University during the pandemic of COVID-19. First, just to give you a brief overview of COVID-19 in Thailand. It all started in January 2020, and further along now, we are faced with the third wave of outbreak with over 2,000 new cases daily. And now to STOU or Sukhothai Thammathirat Open University, which was founded in 1978 as a distance learning institution that uses Thai language as a medium of instruction. The major learning system consists of what we call course block. The course, one course block carries 6 credit hours with 15 weeks of study. The exam takes 3 hours. The major part of the self-learning packages over at STOU are very traditional. Printed materials that we mail to our students, plus supplementary media such as audio and video programs, and some, you know, have face-to-face tutorials at the undergraduate and require some face-to-face seminars at the graduate level. And examinations take place all over the country at secondary schools, in prisons for our inmate students, and with Thai students overseas, we organize examinations at Thai labor offices, embassies, or consulates. And of course, when the pandemic hit, I would like to highlight 2 responses that take place at STOU. The first one is online examination, and the second one is virtual learning environment. The online examination at STOU consists of 3 major components. The first is the Moodle, which is actually the learning management system. And we use the quiz module of the Moodle as a major engine for online examinations. The second part, WebEx, of course, is the web conferencing that is a tool for proctoring and communication between proctors and student takers. And the third, we cannot do without in these days and ages, are cloud services. And from July last year up to the end of January, we organized all together 7 online examinations that students choose to take. And these are told the major stat of the test takers. The first one, we have over 10,000 students taking examinations. And the most recent one at the end of January, we have over 30,000 students taking examinations. And we changed our large auditorium room to become the command center of our online examinations with proctors working together. We provide call centers and LIAD. LIAD is actually WhatsApp, but the LIAD is a application that is popular in this country. So we use those to help our students. And this shows the traffic from various countries throughout the world that come to take our online examinations. The second one I would like to highlight is the virtual learning environment. And of course, our traditional multimedia packages are no longer applicable. It's time for a change. And of course, we still retain the structure of a course block. But what we change is the delivery methods. So these are the 3 major options that we offer. The first is the assignment. And the assignment as the replacement can be either paper-based, and now we move toward online-based via Moodle or Microsoft Teams. For student workshop and trainings, those are a bit tricky. We use mixed methods. And some that do require face-to-face training, what we do is we change some of the learning outcomes that can be done online as a pre-training, so that the student must pass the pre-training workshop to get a ticket to enter the shorter face-to-face training. And of course, for some trainings and workshops, those can be fully online, such as mobile application development. For the tutorial session, I talk about that further. And the fourth one is the graduate student seminars. For graduate students, those are fully online via Moodle or Microsoft Teams. We try to make our media accessible on various platforms, such as we have STOU channel on YouTube. We also have the Facebook. And about a quarter of all our contents are now accessible on mobile devices, ebooks. And of course, the third option is the tutorials. What we do is we have the e-tutorials, which are actually pre-recorded tutorial programs that can be viewed via social media. And the newly introduced is online interactive tutorials, which we offer via Microsoft Teams. And we have over 4,000 students enrolling in our online interactive tutorials. And of course, we want to try to merge all of these contents and delivery methods and contents into what we call STOU portal, which is actually the platform for all our students, so that our students can be on this platform and further their education during the pandemic disruption. Thank you. And hope everybody keeps safe by following the preventive measures to stop the spread and be safe. Thank you again.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Somphorn, for your sharing of the Sukhothai Thammathirath Open University's responses to COVID-19. And as you have already mentioned, Sukhothai Thammathirath Open University used a very traditional methods in order to have the greatest accessibility to the people who may not have access to the digital technology. But with the pandemic that hits Thailand quite badly, it creates great impacts. But then with the agility of the university, Sukhothai Thammathirat Open University has responded very quickly. And we can see that the shifting of the learning and examination to virtual learning and also online examination is the only way to ensure the continuation of the learning and assessment. I also saw from the Q&A tab that there was a question asking about, it's not just the distance learning, it's actually also about the continuation of the internationalization. And that is also true. And ladies and gentlemen, among all the higher education dimensions, internationalization is the area that is directly affected by the pandemic and is following measures of social distancing and traveling restrictions. Our next two speakers are from York University, Canada, Ms. Helen Shor Badurama and Professor Dr. Dominique Chaffel Dunong. Ms. Badurama is the Associate Director, International Partnerships and Programs. She has 20 years experience in international education, working with UNESCO, Asia Europe Foundation and university sector in Canada. She has championing programs and partnerships in Africa, Asia, Europe, and also Americas. She is highly committed and strategically foster York's global engagement and partnerships. So we should be interested to hear how she has to continue with the internationalization efforts. Another speaker who also come from York University is Professor Dr. Dominique Chaffel Dunong. She is the academic lead, globally networked learning initiative and the French study linguistics professor. Her current research is on student-centered learning and open pedagogy in intercultural environments. And I think this is very interesting. She has measured an impact of computation and digitality on education. And with that, she co-leads the French as second language hub with an aim to transform the field of French as a second language to be more equitable, accessible, and inclusive. Ladies and gentlemen, let's hear from them how York University continue and expand their global engagement under the COVID-19 disruptions. Please, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ramyan. It is our great pleasure and honor to join you today. Good morning to our colleagues in Thailand and good day to our friends who are and colleagues joining us from all over the world. My name is Helen Badurama and I'm here with Dr. Dominique Chaffel Dunong to present to you the lessons that we learned from York University's globally networked learning project or initiative during this time of pandemic in the last 12 months. Can we share the slides, please? Thank you. Next slide, please. So just a brief introduction about York University. We are the third largest university in Canada, about 60 years old, and we are a comprehensive university with 11 faculties and 25 interconnected and multidisciplinary research centers. Dr. Ramyan had mentioned that we are a very globally engaged university. We have more than 300 partners from 60 plus countries around the world, and this is reflected in the student body or the student demographics that we have. We have around 56,000 students, and about 20% of these are coming from almost 180 countries across the globe. Of course, apart from our main presence in Canada, we also have two campuses, one in Costa Rica. This is what we call our eco campus and a community engaged campus in Las Nubes. And we have also a campus in Hyderabad, India, through our Schulich School of Business. Dominique, over to you. Next slide, please.
So the globally networked learning started at York. Toronto is a very multicultural city. And to add to the statistics that Ellen mentioned, I will add that, and this is an important element, there is more than 160 languages spoken on campus, and this will have an impact when we're developing globally networked learning at York. So it started as a provost-driven initiative in 2015 with a support from a academic innovation for supporting over 3 years, exploring how we could institutionalize a different way of bringing our students and giving them the opportunity to explore the world like they do when they do exchanges or semester abroad. And it started as well with a very inclusive lens. It was to understand how we can encourage our students to be culturally engaging and with not only students coming from different parts of the world within their classroom, but with students outside the classrooms. And the statistics showing that there was maybe only 3 to 4% of students traveling abroad, we realized that institutionalizing the curriculum or institutionalizing internationalization at home was really not inclusive, and therefore we had to find a different approach to give our students the experience and the opportunity to engage globally on ultimate questions, but at the same time to develop intercultural fluency. So we started with a project that was to experiment with delivering courses and pairing students from York with refugees in the Dada refugee camp. And we explored the COIL, Consortium for Online International Learning, approach that was to encourage faculty members to co-design, co-create courses so that students could have access to dialogues with other students in the world. We did a lot of consultation, and we wanted to institutionalize the approach. And therefore, it took us 3 years to understand what kind of strategy we would need to encourage faculty members to adopt this approach instead of encouraging students to just go abroad. And now COVID-19 arrived, and it gave us the opportunity to learn from what we had, the findings from the consultation, which really helped us focus on a more learner-centered approach to develop globally networked learning, and to think as well at some point of developing open educational resources as outputs of these exchanges between students in different classrooms. Next slide, please. So as I mentioned, and it is very important that it took us 3 years to, I would say, do environmental scan at the university to see how we would pivot internationalization at home with a globally networked learning approach. And it helped us figure out what support we would need to ensure that faculty members would not be scared in trying to co-design either modules or courses or moments in their classroom with other partners in other parts of the world. We realized that we needed the support of libraries so that resources could be shared. We realized we needed the as well support of IT to make sure that students could enroll in learning platforms such as Moodle. And we really needed as well the units which are at the university supporting development for instructors, which are the teaching commons, and where they were already assisting professors to pivot and to I would say remote learning or distance learning. And therefore it was important to train them as well to support our faculty members to pivot to globally networked learning as a enhanced virtually exchange and a more inclusive internationalization of their experiences. Next slide, please. And Helen, it's your turn to talk about our fantastic projects that COVID-19 allowed us to experiment and assess this year.
Thanks, Dominique. So here, just to go over some of the supports that we have put in place so that, as Dominique had mentioned, our faculty members will have the courage to try the GNL approach, the globally networked learning approach. So you have already seen the structure or the framework of a multi-campus partner or multi-unit partners within the campus, right? So we put in place a GNL team, right? In the previous slide, Dominique shared that. We also launched a GNL award. So this is a seed funding for our faculty members so that they can create or experiment with their faculty partners from any country in the world. We also did some professional development and workshops to help them brainstorm ideas on how to pilot GNL within their courses. And of course, a big part of this is communication and awareness building across campus. So we put together a comprehensive website, we launched social media campaigns, and we also did Wi-Fi stories. So we are able to share with you that in the past 10, 11 months, we have implemented 9 GNL projects. And as a team, we are quite proud of this because this is not a very easy task to launch in this current environment. And it's not possible without the collaboration within campus and with our partners around the world. Next slide, please. So I'm not gonna discuss this, but these are the nine projects that have been implemented. So you will see, and you can check this later on when we share the slides with you, it is multidisciplinary. So we have environment, courses in the arts, in refugee studies, in English language teaching, in global health. So really the GNL approach can be applicable to all different disciplines. Next slide, please. Next slide, please.
Thank you.
Next slide, please. So as I had mentioned, I suggest to check those two slides because those are the examples of our faculty members. I'm not gonna do that today because it will take a few minutes to show the videos. Dominique.
Thank you, Ellen. So the 3 years that we explored and did environmental scan at the institutional level, we learned that with a term such as globally networked learning, a lot of people were thinking that technology was key, and we had to really stress the fact that it is actually the human component in globally networked learning that is very important. Because if two instructors or three instructors agreeing to co-design either moments in their class or a whole course cannot first really discuss what are the learning outcomes, what they really want their students to acquire, what kind of skills, and henceforth, what kind of activity would be the most relevant to support those learning outcomes and the skills development so that they are ready for the future of work. It takes already a negotiations between the instructors. And then we realized that what was very important was the negotiations as well with the students. And with the lessons that we learned, we still think that it is not a very inclusive approach until people can just express themselves in their first language. So we're working right now in a way of developing a model so that there is not an imbalance in terms of using only English or using some languages that are, I would say, most commonly spoken. And that's why I said that this is an approach that very much differentiates with what we call, for example, internationalization at home, that can maybe encourage students to develop global engagement, to be aware of the world, to attack challenges in the world. What is really key here is that until they develop an empathy and actually an awareness that there is an imbalance in understanding the other, this is what is key in making the approach inclusive and accessible. So we experimented and went a little bit beyond what the COIL approach was proposing in terms of having instructors co-develop classes. And we added the E at the end of globally networked learning, because with COVID, we realized that from the students' perspective and from the faculty courses that we launched this year, what came out of it, what was very strong, is that people wanted to have the flexibility to add the globally networked learning and to experiment with it. And it allowed us to really start thinking about triangulating educational design research, EDR, and transform the way we're teaching, even co-creating resources, which we are encouraging faculty members and students to create what we call open educational resources as a result of the collaboration. We realized that EDR, educational design research, was helping us assess as we are going along in implementing and institutionalizing GNL. And what we learned as well with these different experiments is that the different outputs from the learning environment and the collaboration really varied. And it was so varied that we thought that what would be interesting would be to start developing a repository of all of these resources so that they can be transformed in how-to guides or workshops. And then that would help us scale the learning aspect for faculty members and for students and for staff in different faculties that support teaching and learning. So the flexibility first and the learning first somehow helped us imagine that the best research approach, not only to assess what has been developed this year, but to scale it so that the internationalization at home and the virtually exchange program that we are offering with GNL can really, within the next 3 years, be totally across the university and engaging, I would say, at least more than 3,000 students, because that would be for us a success to think that instead of a few students being able to go abroad, engaging within our campuses more than 3,000 students a year would be the way we are measuring it. So we're using EDR, and this is allowing us to put knowledge and knowledge funds of faculty and form students first, and use this to develop open educational resources that are shared with the partner institutions that we are creating courses and modules, learning models for GNL, or for countries which at the moment are, as someone mentioned today, I think it was the introductory professor, the digital divide. We think that this is very important to have repository with examples of OER based on what GNL is doing so that we can share the lesson learned with the rest of the world. And Helen, I think you're going to now take over and talk about how we need the institutional support and strong partnership to really scale up the GNL, not only at York, but across with our partner institution.
Thanks, Dominique. So of course, we already mentioned this in the beginning. The main thing that really helped push the GNL initiative at York is the collaboration of the different faculties and units. So it is very important to have the institutional support, both from the grassroots and from the senior leaders. So we have seen that the provost has invested funding. There is the different administrative supports and units that are collaborating with faculty members. And the same faculty members who initiated these 9 projects in 2020 will also be a resource for future faculty members who want to try out the GNL approach. And we call it they are trailblazers, right? Because they were brave enough to try this approach, and they will be part of a community of practice. So that's part of the supports that we are offering. And then, of course, the strong partnerships is key, very, very important, because the only reason that we can call this globally networked learning is when two or three faculty members are collaborating. So we rely on the partnerships of the international offices of our partners, as well as the collaboration of the respective faculties and faculty members. Next slide, please. So these are the GNL projects that have happened or that were implemented in 2020. So we had 10 unique experiences. As Dominique had mentioned, we were not limiting ourselves to course-to-course collaboration. And we recognize that some of these experiments have to take place in smaller number of activities, right? On a smaller scale. It could be 2 or 3 weeks instead of a 12-week collaboration. And then you will see here as well the types of collaborative projects that the students themselves were involved in. So they did case competitions. So they put together policy briefs. An example of this is for our global health program, where our students from Germany, Romania, and Canada studied the COVID-19 policies that were implemented in these three countries. Next slide, please.
Helen, would you wrap up in maybe 2 minutes, please?
Thanks, Dr. Ramian. So here you will see the impact, right? So the number of the students that we touched, both from Canada at York University and from our partner universities. So within these 9 GNL projects, we have touched more than 500 students. So this is where we can see the impact and the potential of this approach. Next slide, please. And this is what we've heard from our students. So many of them recognize the importance of seeing and meeting different types of people, although this is done through online learning or online collaboration. And even one student mentioned that it has an amazing upside to Corona, the GNL approach. Next slide, please. Dominique, I think this is yours.
And from the faculty perspective, what was very important that we realized that to push for a learner-centered and resource-driven learning approach, we really needed to support students to be experimental and open in the way they were exploring with their partners ways of pivoting internationalization at home, but doing it, it with COVID-19 and with globally networked learning virtually and humanly. That's what we learned. People actually realize that there are ways of being extremely human within screens, and that's what came out of some of the assessment as well. So next slide, please.
So this is just to give you a picture of what had happened, right? We had the traditional global engagement activities, the semester exchanges. It was moved to remote in 2020. International internships, also remote. Summer programs canceled. But the GNL helped us continue and expand international engagement. So our vision is for this to continue beyond COVID. Next slide, please.
And to wrap up, beyond talking about the increase of GNL environments at York, I think that what is very important is the creative way of developing open pedagogical resources for the community at York and beyond, because it is creating new knowledge. It is creating as well different type of knowledge, and all of this being encapsulated in either knowledge product or educational resources that will be deposited on a repository is increasing as well our understanding of how to label our knowledge across culture and across countries and across disciplines. So everybody is becoming a learner, the faculty, the staff, the students, in this new relationship with knowledge. And this is based, of course, and thanks to a research-based knowledge educational approach that will allow us to reflect on how educational innovation can transform educational practice. We are reflecting as well with those documents being archived on our own practices and scaling the learn lesson so that everybody can add. And this is building and growing a community of practice beyond an institutions and making it cross and global, cross-discipline and global as well. Next slide, please. And this is all of the information that you can reach.
Right. Okay, thank you very much. And I think we can put the PowerPoint presentation onto the Handouts tabs. So if you want to download the presentation, then you can do that. Thank you very much, Ms. Bandelaria and also Professor Shafal Dunong for an impressive presentation of the 3 years' work. It seems like it's longer than that to have this kind of achievement. And I think the sharing of the York University, you can see that the continuation of the internationalization can happen even amidst the COVID-19 situation. But we have to be sure of why we are doing the internationalization. The approach of it, which York University has already identified that it is to institutionalize the internationalization at home for the critical mass, being resourceful in a sense that they are taking all the context that they have at the strength to create the programs. They also do the environmental scanning and also design the programs in a very inclusive ways. So with that, I would like to congratulate York University. Next, we will have the presentation from Ms. Sophie Bonichon. We'll move up to the regional responses to the COVID-19. Ms. Bonichon is the associate expert from Eurachet, Belgium. She has an expertise in the internationalization of education. And during 2009 to 2013, she has been appointed an expert of European Bologna process for European higher education area by the French Ministry of Higher Education. She has been very committed for promoting the EU instruments and mechanisms, including the credit transfer systems, the qualification framework, quality assurance, and now she is working on the recognition issues of the lifelong learning. And with that introduction, please let us enjoy her PowerPoint presentation, which is pre-recorded.
Greetings from Europe and from France. As I'm recording my presentation, I will just introduce myself very briefly. Many thanks to CINIO for inviting me to the 2021 Congress. I'm very pleased to share with you today. So my name is Sylvie Bonichon. I'm French. I'm an educationalist acting as a consultant for a European international organization. Today I am representing Eurachet. Here is the content of my presentation with another view of the EU context and two European examples of good practices. A few words about Eurachet. Eurachet stands for European Association of Institutions in Higher Education, offering professional higher education. Eurachet cooperates with European and international organizations through projects and research activities and the bell, and act as a consultative member participating in the European Higher Education Area Ministerial Conferences. The European Higher Education Area is an intergovernmental cooperation in the field of higher education. implementing a common set of commitments, structural reforms, and shared tools. There is a ministerial conference every 2 years to review on what has been achieved and make new commitments and decisions. The last conference took place in 2020 in November, and one of the key priorities is digitalization. Erasmus Plus is the flagship program of education in Europe, providing support and finance. You can see that digitalization transformation is logically one of the strategic priorities of the project. So here are the key actions for which there are calls for support and thus for money. So you can apply for actions at individual level for mobility and intensive program, at institutional level for cooperation projects and European universities, at policy level for support to policy development and cooperation. For the period 21 to 27, the budget allocated to the higher education sector is more than 6 billion, which is great. So, first example, the EU universities initiative. It's an Erasmus Plus project. What is the format of the European universities? It's a partnership, an alliance with all types of higher education institutions across Europe. They define a common strategy that should include the strategic priorities we have already mentioned. They form, and this is quite unique, virtual and face-to-face EU inter-university campuses. And they use innovative digital models for higher education. They are open to a wide diversity of students at all levels of studies who have access to a variety of courses and so can build their own program. Students can also experience mobility that is possible physically, online, or in blended mode. Reports show that the strong existing cooperation in European universities project has increased their capacity for flexibility and for boosting their process towards digitalization at all institutional levels. For example, for faculty members in the co-construction of new modules online or in the conversion of face-to-face teaching into virtual teaching using new tools and appropriate pedagogy. They could also improve their skills in digitalization and the related methodology, pedagogy, and technology via peer learning activities or capacity building sessions. For students, it also seems to be easier since the EU universities format enables them to switch from one campus to another without any complicated procedure. If you want to have some more concrete examples, you can find them easily on the internet. Currently, there are 41 alliances and 280 higher education institutions involved, representing 7 million euros already allocated by the European Union. It will be more. For the current phase. Example number two is about the card, the student call. So what is the student call? It's a digital card indeed. The concept is simple, but it can do lots of things. So the digital student card that will offer a lot of opportunity, simplifying all the processes students have to go through during his or her studies. So it complies with the data protection legislation in Europe, of course, but it will especially facilitate the mobility and recognition processes that often implies a lot of documents. So now it's without paper. And it will give students access to online courses, for example, facilitate virtual mobility and blended learning, and also enlarges the choice in programs offer. They will get access to services provided at other higher education institutions. And they will even allow discounts on cultural activities around Europe. The full deployment of the European Student Card will be this year, 2021. I forgot to tell that this initiative was coupled with another initiative called Erasmus Without Data. I just would like to add that the recognition and the mobility processes are possible thanks to existing new common mobility processes and documents that are used for master students and to EU common instruments and tools also, such as the ECTS, the European Credit Transfer System, and the learning outcomes, etc. So as a conclusion, why transforming Europe in the digital era? Sometimes digitalization has been considered as wonderful. Sometimes it has been considered as so as boring, because during this pandemic, spending a whole day in front of computer and without having the possibility to meet the people has been sometimes very difficult, especially for students. So I just would like to say that for me, digitalization is just for inclusion and not for division. It's for interactivity and sharing and not for studying alone. It's for diversity and appropriateness of pathways, but not for limitations. And it's for quality assured and sustainable education. It's for enjoying teaching, carrying out research, innovating, and being flexible and mobile, even virtually. Yet, this being said, I'm still very looking forward to meeting you all for real. So thanks for your attention and take care. And please, if you need any information, if you have any questions, do not hesitate to contact me via email. Bye.
Thank you very much, Ms. Panishans, for the sharing the responses of the EU to the COVID-19, which is highlighting two good practices of the student cards, which allow more access, and also the EU new EU initiatives. So next, I would like to introduce our last speaker, but not least. We have with us Dr. Martin, Randall Martin, who is the Executive Director of British Columbia Council for International Education. He has an extensive experience working on the international education and also working on the post-secondary education. So with this brief presentation, brief introduction, I would like to invite Dr. Martin, please. The floor is yours.
Okay. Hi, good morning. It's good evening from Vancouver. It's 9:30 p.m. Thank you, Dr. Romian. Thank you to Simeo, our friend from Dr. Valenzuela and colleagues. I know that Joe Biden was on earlier delivering his State of the Union address, so I'm glad you came to our session after his session was completed. I've got, I think, 9 minutes. Hopefully I can get through this in time. I don't have a PowerPoint, so you just have to listen to me. We're talking about transforming higher education. Essentially, transformation is a fancy word for change. Change can come gradually, as with evolution, or suddenly, as with revolution. It can be subtle as a tide, or dramatic and radical, able to transform something like an egg to a caterpillar, to a chrysalis, to a butterfly. So where are we in that cycle in terms of the transformation of higher education? Are we ready to fly? There is no doubt that education is currently experiencing a radical change, a very noticeable acceleration of the technological change that has been at work in education for at least 50 years, inspired most recently by the COVID pandemic. As we prepare for and attempt to lead this new transformation of higher education, it's beneficial to be reminded that experience begets behavior. In science, they say that ontogeny recapitulates phylogeny. An understanding of historical precedent is perhaps our best recourse to figure out how a higher education might be transformed. Plato argued that it's the role of the state to educate its citizenry, to educate each individual for the place and work to which he is best fitted. Aristotle agreed that the state should educate its citizenry to play their parts in society. Education has invariably evolved during its lifetime, but its core tenet has always remained unchanged. It is the process of receiving or giving systemic instruction, or the process of transmitting knowledge and learning. The medium may have changed several times, but the message has remained the same, and educators use the tools that they have at hand. It may be, however, that the current transformation underway is changing both the medium and the message, both delivery and content. I'm not an academic, I'm a generalist, I'm a bureaucrat, so I'm going to speak from a very macro level here. Early education was first and foremost an oral exchange of information. As it became systematized, one of the first major transformations or revolutions took place some 2,500 years ago, when the oral exchange between teacher and student was augmented by reading and writing, and when the discipline of memorization was replaced by the rigidity of the written word, and later, especially after Gutenberg, with the printed page. A second major transformation, beginning in Europe approximately 1,100 years ago, saw the creation of formalized centers of learning, the first universities such as Bologna, Paris, Oxford, and Salamanca, where students lived together and where students and teachers began to share the same facilities such as libraries and laboratories, marking the beginning of educational communities, campus life, and the scholarly tradition. This phenomenon attracted state and church attention, and with that attention came greater human and financial resources not previously available, resulting in the creation of bricks and mortar centers and an increasingly complex ecosystem of instructors, administrators, technicians, staff, students, publishers, etc., culminating most recently in the institutionalization and codification of once obscure practices such as marketing, recruitment, admissions, standardized testing, credit transfer, letters of permission, quality assessment, and rankings. It's my belief that the massification of higher education can be viewed as the third major transformation of higher education. Massification was a response to the post World War II baby boom demographics, which impacted higher education globally, a response to exploding populations that espoused access to education for all rather than just for the few. Once viewed as a purview of the elite, the 1960s forced higher education to offer greater access for the masses, concurrent with the demographic echo of the post-war baby boom, spawning trends such as the creation and explosive growth of universities around the world during the 1960s. broader access to post-secondary education, and the revision and introduction of curricula to better address local economic needs and forecasts was an attempt to build better connections between local economies and the aspirations of growing populations and middle classes. While in former times universities might have been described as elite or exclusionary, today higher education has been democratized and has argued that universities are for everyone and that education is a right. So as we transform, we can travel from Gutenberg to Zuckerberg. The most recent transformation of higher education, I would argue, initially impacting mass education in the 1970s and 1980s, is an immediate result of massification. It is the change that has made educational content more accessible to ever more learners, made possible by computing, video, and telecommunications. Some of you might remember moving from a typewriter to a computer. Some of you might remember your first email address. That all happened in the 1980s. This has been termed the technology revolution, and it has encouraged an inevitable change in the way higher education delivers its services and its products. The character of this change may not be yet clear. Personal computers, mobile phones, and ubiquitous internet access have made education dramatically more accessible to a greater diversity and larger number of students who no longer need to travel miles to campus, live in dormitories, or study from textbooks in order to study, learn, and experience. Though bricks and mortar campuses are still very much a part of the experience and will remain so, the diversity of ways that people can now learn and earn a degree vastly differs from what early educators initially envisioned. These technologies have been transforming how instruction and learning take place. Technology is replacing old models of standardized rote learning and ideally created more personalized self-directed experiences for students. The current COVID pandemic, however, has quite rudely put the technology revolution on steroids and has rapidly accelerated existing trends towards the use of technology in learning. The technology revolution we now call the digital age. The pandemic has forced educators to confront realities they may have been hesitant to consider just 2 years ago. It has forced the academy to quickly and radically pivot all content online, and with that, to adjust and rethink age-old and proven classroom methodologies. The academy must now ponder the possibility of long-term and perhaps even more radical change to the age-old business model. Face-to-face has become virtual, mobility has become immobility. To Zoom used to mean to go somewhere quickly. MOOCs were going to change the academy, but they didn't. But pre-pandemic, technology had already changed traditional modes of delivery and interaction, and with that, content. Even before the pandemic, global access to content had been exponentially increased, and online delivery was already omnipresent in organized learning. Students in slums could study on their phones. Technology's ability to instantaneously create levels of interconnectedness had put globalization on steroids and allowed greater global discourse, trade, migration, and contact. It must, however, as several speakers have mentioned today, be pointed out that we are not all on the same side of the digital divide. The pandemic has changed many lives, but with young people and children, vulnerable communities, and the poor experiencing the biggest disruption. It is still the case that millions on the wrong side of the digital divide have no opportunity to access learning or to continue learning. Access to technology and connectivity may be the new dividing line between the elite and the others in education, where that divide used to be access to education is now access to technology. Technology will invariably be the primary force in the build back, but these new disparities must be addressed. It is clear that this digital age will alter the future of education. It may provide yet another stepping stone, foundation, or platform for the fundamental reorganization of higher learning, both content and delivery, offering both an advanced medium and a different message. Regardless, much of the sector is waiting a return to the normalcy of gradual change, not transformation. But like a second marriage, this may represent victory of hope over experience. Yet many others are very excited by the prospect of fundamental change to the modes and manner of educational delivery. George Harrison said, "All things must pass," and this pandemic will end, and many things will return to some semblance of the old normal. We should not waste the pandemic, however, and we should clearly identify and hold on to whatever possible gains we have made. A return to in-person learning will be important, but perhaps a return that is supplemented by remote learning opportunities. Education remains a social enterprise, and experiential learning remains fundamental. It's not yet clear how much and what manner of experience can be delivered online. New collaborative media, which we've heard about earlier, and concepts such as COIL must be embraced, especially as an augmentation, a hybrid, or a remote-friendly alternative to physical or student mobility. Less obvious are perhaps some of the other ways in which our landscape has changed. Micro-credentials have the real potential to force a reimagination of what a degree looks like and where it comes from. Gamification is changing the way students experience coursework, allowing them to explore advanced concepts in an active, adaptive learning environment. The transformation of learning in the digital age is well underway, but other forces of change to learning are also at play. The demographics and learning styles of new generations of learners must be accommodated, as must lifelong learning for the rest of us. We must anticipate the entrance of more and larger commercial organizations and private education into higher education, as well as declining state support for public education, global urbanization, and the accelerated move from an industrial to an information society. The impact of technological change and the digital age will also be felt in other parts of the education ecosystem. These changes will affect non-teaching staff and the manner and type of services they provide. Remote teaching will lessen the need for academic residency, for private academic offices, or for free parking for teachers. These are all big issues. Libraries will look different. There will be changes to the selection, training, and onboarding of new staff, personnel, and technicians, with a need for revised and new metrics for quality and performance. These will be reflected in new collective bargaining and other fundamental changes in the workplace. There will be enhanced need for institutions to differentiate themselves and in their ability to market themselves when their product is plain for all to see. And so if higher education and the academy are to assess and improve the rate and efficacy of change that the digital age brings, educational institutions will need to seek partnerships with learners, industry, and government, and to support the implementation of these technologies. The medium might change, but the message has remained the same. Thanks very much for your patience. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Martin, for your wisdom in sharing and, you know, going back in time and explaining that the transformation is not something new, but is something that happens and we need to actually transform our higher education. So with that, I think we are run out of time, but I would like to invite all of you. I saw a few questions, very interesting questions. I would like to invite all of you to go to the tables. You would see the tab on the left. And you go to table 46, which is the empty table, grab a chair, and we can continue the discussion. So hopefully we will see each other there, and have a good day. Thank you very much.
Yes. Thank you very much, Dr. Romien. Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes the session. Please stay tuned for our next session, parallel session 4. Thank you very much.
of the International Science, Mathematics, and Technology Education Conferences. Currently, he lives in Bangkok, where he is a senior specialist at the Simeo Regional STEM Education Center and editor-in-chief of the Southeast Asian Journal of STEM Education. He received his BA in Liberal Arts with a biology major from Drake University and a Master of Science and PhD in Science Education from the University of Iowa in the US. Dr. Stiles.
Thank you, Tristan, very much. Welcome, everybody. Glad you're here. We're really excited about this presentation. So I will have Tristan now introduce my colleague, Ed Reeve.
That's me. Over here.
And here's our second speaker. Dr. Edward M. Reeve is a professor and teacher educator in the area of technology and engineering education in the School of Applied Sciences, Technology, and Education at Utah State University. He has been at USU since 1987, where he has worked to advance knowledge in the fields of technology and engineering education in career and technical education. His professional interests, research, and numerous publications and presentations have been in areas related to educational standards, curriculum development in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics education, competency-based education, and improving teaching and learning. Dr. Reeve received his PhD in education in industrial technology from the Ohio State University. For more than 20 years, he has worked with various universities, government, and non-government organizations in Asia to improve methods and practices in education. He's a former Fulbright scholar and Fulbright senior specialist in Thailand and American Council on Education fellow. He has experiences as a secondary education teacher, a university administrator, and is a recent past president of the International Technology and Engineering Educators Education Association. Everyone, please welcome Dr. Reeve.
Thank you. Well, let's get going because we have a lot to do. Today, the presentation outline, we're going to look at, I'm going to give you an introduction to STEM education. We're going to look at the components of STEM. And then we're going to look at scientific inquiry. Dr. Stiles will do that. And I'll cover engineering design. And the theme of this conference is, you know, digital world. And both of these can be done in a virtual world using the internet. And then we'll conclude. So let's begin with an introduction to STEM education to help set the context here. So what is STEM education? Many are still confused by the meaning of STEM education. I tell them we're involved in STEM education. Sometimes, oh, I know about the stem cell. Well, we're not about that. But many are still confused, and there are many definitions. At the STEM Ed Center, where we're both John and I serve as consultants, we have come up with a definition of STEM Ed, and I'll share that with you today. And this definition is available at the CMEO, stemed.org. And STEM Ed is defined as a teaching and learning approach, which emphasizes the connections among or the integration of knowledge and skills in science, technology, and mathematics to address problems facing our communities as well as larger global issues. It requires a skilled workforce and knowledgeable citizens who can apply these skills and knowledge to develop solutions. So this is a STEM Ed definition as defined by the STEMEO STEM Ed Center. What is STEM education? STEM education is all about integration and is appropriate for any grade level. Integration helps students see the big picture and improves learning. STEM education promotes students learning analytical skills, or these 21st skills of communication, creativity, critical thinking, data analysis, and research. STEM education promotes students learning about STEM careers. Here in the U.S., we believe a STEM-educated workforce helps to keep a nation competitive in the global economy, and this is for everyone around the world. And I think it's important that we teach our students that many STEM careers do not require a college degree. Most of the people think of STEM, they think of an engineer or a doctor, but there are so many other careers like a technician or a mechanic. Those type of careers are STEM careers, but they don't require a college degree. as all of us know, STEM education is a teaching and learning approach, but it requires quality teachers. We all know that a teacher makes the difference. Actually, the student there on the floor is one of my former teachers. So a good teacher makes the difference. We all know that. STEM education is a teaching and learning approach that promotes using engineering design process and scientific inquiry. And we'll be talking about more about that as this presentation progresses. STEM education is a teaching and learning approach that is needed for preparing the alpha generation. If you listened to the opening yesterday, they talked about the alpha generation. These are our young children born after 2010. I actually have a couple grandchildren, and they've only known screens all their entire life. This is the alpha generation. I happen to be a baby boomer. So now let's look at the components of STEM. Again, to help set the context here, the components of STEM, and I define them by the Standards for Technology and Engineering Literacy, or STEL, and this is the role of technology and engineering in STEM education. This is by my professional association. We did these new standards, and it's a free download at www.itea.org. You get the Standards for Technology and Engineering Literacy. So to set the context, what is science? Of course, science involves the investigation and understanding of the natural world. Let's take a fun look at science here.
Evidence is like a clue that something is true. Scientists collect evidence through observations and experiments. Scientists use evidence to understand the world around us. Around us. We need evidence to help us support our ideas. The more evidence we have, the stronger our idea is. Scientists use evidence to understand the world around us. Around us. Evidence is like a clue that something is true. Scientists collect evidence through observations and experiments. Scientists use evidence to understand the world around us. Around us.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that short video there. It's a fun look at science. So science is about studying the natural world. Let's continue here. What is technology, my field of study? Technology is the modification of the natural environment through human design products, systems, and processes to satisfy needs and wants. Technology satisfies humans' needs and wants. Technology is involved in many computerized engineering efforts. GM to run robot cars in San Francisco without human backups. That's technology. Again, it's involved in many computerized engineering efforts. I saw this on news here. It's about Michaela. It's actually a sophisticated computer algorithm programmed to pretend to be a 19-year-old Brazilian-American Instagram influencer. It has over 4 million views when I looked at it. Incredible. Some people think she's real. Some teenagers may think she's real, but she's not. This was in our news last week. Technology involved, again, in many computerized engineering efforts. Amazon brings its palm screening payment tech to Whole Foods, which is a grocery store. Would you use it? So instead of, you know, even using your phone, you can just use your palm print. It'll be linked to your credit card. You can use it. Again, technology is more than computers. We need to teach our students that computers, technology is more than computers. You'll see pictures here, the hammer, the screwdriver, the safety glasses, the calculator, the microscope, the Bunsen burner. These are all technological tools. This is technology. The safety glasses is a technology to present our eyes. And technology has existed since the beginning of humankind. Again, technology is more than just computers. Here are some of the tech trends. I'm not going to read them all. But you've probably heard some of these. This is what's happening here in the 21st, in 2021. These are some of the tech trends that are happening here. We'll continue on now. What is engineering? engineering is the use of scientific principles and mathematical reasoning to optimize technologies in order to meet the needs that have been defined by criteria under constraints. Engineering creates technology. Engineering is the process of designing the human-made world. Engineers apply knowledge and skills to solve problems, where scientists ask questions. They explore the natural world to discover new knowledge about it. What is engineering? Well, it's a noun. It's a study of engineering, civil, mechanical, electrical, chemical. And engineering is also can be used as a verb. And it's using engineering design and the application of engineering to habits, mind. And this verb here is the focus in education, looking at engineering design, which is a problem-solving process, and habits of mind, which are these 21st century skills. It's how engineers come up with solutions to problems or improvements to current technologies. Engineering habits of mind. And those are the six that are really stressed in technology and engineering education. Let's take a fun look at engineering. You saw science. Let's take a look at engineering.
Solve lots of problems. They design, test, and build. Every time they redesign, the solution might get better. This is what we call engineering, and this is what an engineer does. This is what we call engineering, using science and math to solve problems. Engineers solve lots of problems. They design, test, and build. Every time they redesign, the solution might get better. This is what we call engineering, and this is what an engineer does. This is what we call engineering, using science and math to solve problems.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that video there. I hope you got you up dancing a little bit. Let's continue here. What is math? Of course, mathematics enables communication and critical analysis of how we make sense of the human and natural world using numbers and computational reading. I've just reviewed the components of STEM as defined by the Standards for Technological Engineering Literacy. Again, there are many definitions of science, technology, engineering, and math, but this is one presentation that shows the context that we use. Remember, STEM is involved in almost everything. You take a simple water bottle, you look at science, it's involved in cleaning the water, engineering, the machines that fill the bottles, technology, the bottle and the cap, the math, the amount of fluid. When we teach STEM education, we need to show this integration. STEM impacts our foods, our transportation, our housing, and how we communicate. And remember, STEM is needed to achieve many of the sustainable development goals they talked about in yesterday's presentation. STEM will be an important part of this. Here's an example of STEM, a short video, how STEM working together. Enjoyed that short presentation there, and it shows an example of how science, technology, engineering, and math needed to work together. I'm now going to turn the presentation over to John, Dr. Stiles, who's going to talk about the interactive practices in STEM education. He's going to talk about science inquiry. Dr. Stiles?
Thank you very much, Ed. I appreciate that. Great. I just noticed also in that video for the first time that it was written in Thai, but there are 17,000 people involved in that project. So it involves quite a lot of effort in a collaborative effort, and that's a really big part of STEM education as well. I had a few questions that came up about, will this PowerPoint be available, made available to the viewers? And the answer to that is yes. Ed, I believe you're going to share that at the end of our presentation. Is that right?
That's correct.
Okay. And he'll have some other resources available too. And it's also being recorded. My understanding is that you can access these recordings, or will be able to, from the Cineo website, and they link it to YouTube videos. I think that's correct. So let me talk a little bit about science inquiry. And the word inquiry is very important here. Traditionally, science has not been taught as an inquiry subject. It's been taught as an information subject, where students learn to memorize information, and that's about it. So the reason we use the word inquiry is because that's what scientists use. They use they are inquiring about natural phenomena. They ask questions and try to answer those questions. So in education, scientific inquiry is about teachers asking questions about how something works, and students also ask questions, and then students collect the evidence and propose explanations. In traditional education, if an activity is done, it's usually the teacher telling the students how to proceed through. But in STEM education and science inquiry, that doesn't happen. It's more student-centered. Okay, next, Ed. So we're all born very curious. We are scientists in many ways from very early age. We wonder how things work. Young children question, they experiment with cause and effect in their everyday lives. And in the classroom, scientific inquiry provides a platform for this continuation of student curiosity and solving problems and answering questions. And so we call this a student-centered approach, where students are the main focus of this teaching strategy. So an effective question isn't one that just asks students to repeat information. That's a recall question, but effective questions are ones that require students to think critically and creatively in order to answer it. Recall questions are important about learning information and vocabulary, but they don't require students to think critically. A teacher that I worked with, actually a colleague of mine, and then as a consultant, I worked with her, physics teacher in the United States, who won a presidential award for excellence in science teaching, once said, "Telling isn't teaching, and listening isn't learning." And I think those two statements say a tremendous amount about what STEM education can do and does do for students and for teachers as well. Because we learn by doing science. We don't learn by just listening about science. I'm going to talk a little bit about an example of an inquiry, science inquiry exploration that I have used in the past, and I still use it in workshops for teachers. It's a very simple one. It can be done virtually, excuse me, or in the classroom, of course. What we do in science inquiry is we first develop the concept through questioning students. So the strategy would be to find out what students know about the topic that you are going to be teaching. And there are many ways to do that. One of the ways I like to use is to first ask students what they know about the topic. In this case, electricity. I would ask them, write down everything you know about electricity. And then they share those ideas. And then, what do you think you know about electricity? And finally, what would you like to know about electricity? And this helps me and teach other teachers understand students' current knowledge about the topic. And it also can help help the teacher pinpoint misconceptions that students have, and then they could use those as a way to change the misconceptions. Go back, Ed. I think there's a little bit more. You go back one. Yeah, and so what I ask them to do after we've done that is we get suggestions about what are some examples that where you use electricity, and of course it's everywhere around us: lights, switches, all kinds of ignitions, things like that. Electricity is everywhere. We don't even think about it, but we don't necessarily know how it works. So I give the students a battery, a small light bulb, which you can find in flashlights or torches, as they're known in the British world, and a wire, one wire. And I asked him to make the bulb light. Now, many students and some teachers in my workshop say, I can't make it light. I need two wires to do that. And I say, you can do it. Just see if you can find out. And so they work sometimes in pairs. They can work at home on this as long as they have the materials and they can get them ahead of time. And they take some time. It doesn't take very long to figure out how to make the bulb light, at least one way. But there are actually four ways. So once they have learned to light it, I'll say to them, okay, that's great. Now find three more ways, three more configurations. And it's amazing. One of the risks about virtual learning like this is that when you give students a challenge to do something, often they will go right to the internet to see if they can find out the right answer, which defeats the purpose of the exploration in which you're trying to help students develop the concept by actively being involved in exploration. I've even had teachers do it in workshops. As soon as I give them this problem, they go to their computer and want to look up the answer. But once we discuss it, they understand that there's a reason that we do this. We're not looking for what someone else has found. We're looking for what they can find. And that really helps develop a deeper understanding of the topic. Okay, next slide, please. And so when they are doing this, they draw a simple diagram of what works and what doesn't work.
Okay.
Next, yeah. Once they have found out the four different ways to, and I hope that those of you watching are not on the internet now looking for the answers. If you want to know, try it yourself. It really will help you. Once they do this, I ask them to write a rule for making the bulb light. And the rule has to work for all four ways. And that's not as easy as it sounds. They struggle with that, but it helps them develop their communication skills, their thinking skills, and their collaboration skills with their classmates. Of course, you can extend this by adding more bulbs, more wires, more batteries, having students explore different ways to make bulbs light. And often what they will do is they will come up with the two different circuits that are well known, the series and parallel circuits, on their own without knowing what they're called. Okay, Ed, next. So once they've done this, the students explain what they observed. They compare what they've observed and how they explain it to what scientists say. So this is where the content comes in and the vocabulary. It doesn't happen before the activity. It happens during the activity after students have done their observations. And so they learn their content. They learn vocabulary. So examples for vocabulary would be in primary grades, the term circuit is sufficient to help students explain what happens in electricity, how electricity works. For middle school, they learn a little bit more sophisticated vocabulary, of course, series and parallel circuits, conductors, insulators, for example, and in high school, more sophisticated vocabulary and problems to solve. Next. So students can then apply their new knowledge in problem solving. What I often do with this particular activity is that I challenge students or teachers in my workshop to use what they have learned about circuitry to develop an alarm, a door or window alarm that works when the door or window opens. And they use cardboard boxes as a model, and then they wire everything. And this is a little tricky because it's easy to make an alarm where you make a connection by closing a door or window. But when you open a door or window, that causes them to think a lot more critically about how to do that. Okay, next. This is a photo of a teacher workshop that I was doing where a group were working on connecting the bulbs and batteries in various ways. It's a lot of fun and they learn a lot. Teachers admit, and I admitted when I first did it, that I learned a lot about electricity that I didn't know beforehand. As a biology teacher, I learned quite a lot about physical science. There are five essential features of scientific inquiry that can be used in the classroom. This was developed by the National Research Council in the United States. And there are five of these features that if you're doing a full inquiry, it includes all of these. The first one is that there's a question about a scientific phenomenon that's posed by the teacher, or it could come from a student. Sometimes it comes from the textbook. Secondly, students investigate that question and they gather data about it. Once they've gathered their data, sufficient data, then they analyze it and offer explanations for what that data mean. And then they connect their explanation with those of the scientists, like I mentioned before. This is where the content development comes in, the content knowledge. And I want to say something about that content knowledge. Often the students learn content before they actually get to this step, because they've been working on this and they've come up with their own explanations, which are correct. And number five, the students communicate and justify their findings. They can do this as a classroom. They could do it in an expo for the school. They can do it in many, many different situations. But the important thing is that they have to figure out a way to take all that they have learned and present it to an audience. And that's really important to develop that communication skills. And we know that the best way to learn something, this is backed by years of research, the best way to learn something is to teach it to other people. That's the most powerful way to learn. Okay, next. I want to give you some examples of an activity that I do with my advanced biology students in my last teaching role. And we use these small larvae. Many of you know them as mealworms. They're known by different names in different countries, of course. And they eventually become adult beetles, or what we call darkling beetles. These can be found in pet shops, markets where they sell fish and other animals that eat these things. But they're really easy to keep and really great for observation in the classroom. And they also go through a metamorphosis in less than a month, so they can learn about the life cycle of insects. So here's what my students came up with after investigating the mealworms, or just actually observing the mealworms. These are some examples that they developed and actually did in the classroom. Crickets were easily obtainable from pet shops. So many of them use crickets to investigate things like what happens if it's raining, what happens if they're exposed to different amounts of light, what do mealworms do when the temperature is changed in their environment. And they even were able to set up different chambers in which the humidity was different, and they wanted to see how mealworms reacted to those. Some other ones. Again, crickets, they use different soil types to see if crickets and preferred one or the other. They were actually able to determine water temperature, the optimum water temperature for goldfish. Humidity, even on toads, they brought in toads to the classroom and were able to take a look at how humidity affects their behavior. And then also things like the dampness, different chambers of relatively increased amounts of moisture in the environment. Okay, so I know that this has gone very quickly, but I wanted to give you an example of what you can do in the classroom. The important thing is is looking at the methodology, and that's really, really important, is how you teach it. The methodology is the same no matter what the topic is. It starts with a question. Students are involved in investigating. To answer that question in some way, they collect data, the mathematics of it, they collect and analyze the data, they graph it in appropriate ways. They explain what they found, they learn the content behind it, and then of course they can apply it. This video that I'm gonna ask Ed to play is one of a middle school in the state of Colorado in the United States. And it is a school that has won many awards for its innovative teaching. I like it because even though this is something that would be very difficult to do virtually, it's not impossible to do virtually, where you assign different students to collect data, but it could be done. And if you can do it in a classroom, it's obviously better. So let's take a look.
This is still settling, but we found a lot of little organisms.
So cool. The real question we're trying to answer here is if it's safe to tube in the water, because I swim here every summer, and
I just realized how
dirty it was.
When we design a science lesson to be an inquiry-based lesson, we start everything around a central question that may last for one class period or a series of class periods. And then they work through some experiment and conversation, perhaps some reading, and they work together. And the answers are always just a little bit out of reach for the kids until they really reach a point where they have this sense of discovery. Each of you are going to be in a group where you're going to sample one parameter down at the creek. And then you're going to make a infographic about your parameters. So for example, maybe it will be temperature and turbidity. And then ultimately, what you're going to have to decide in your final prompt is going to be answering this question. Would you recommend to your friends coming from out of town that they go tubing in Boulder Creek?
If you just ask a question and then gave the answer, it would be the same as if you just read the textbook. So we don't like to do that. We like to ask the question and then give a lot of different experiences, both through media, through discussion, through research, so kids can start to answer that question themselves.
When we actually go down to the creek, it's an exciting day for the kids. We've talked up the idea that we're really in an outdoor classroom. Let's find a spot and let's sit down and start working on our physical survey of the area, everybody. So you'll work on your map first. Suddenly they're looking at it through a different lens. They're looking at it through a lens as a place where we're now going to be doing some sampling and some scientific thinking. If the water appears clear, is it clean? And then if it's not clean, what does that mean?
Mr. Short gave us bugs that can live in healthy water and bugs that can live in unhealthy water.
Yeah.
We're gonna find which bugs are we finding here, and if they're all in like unhealthy water bugs, then we're gonna like, no, this is unhealthy water.
I think it's 5 ppm.
5 ppm, yeah.
From what we found, there wasn't as much nitrate as we thought there would be.
We would still go swimming even though it seems pretty dirty, but we know that it's just, there's a lot of organisms in here, and that leads us to believe that it's actually pretty healthy.
And we spend the next class period sort of going through that data, and they put that into a poster, an infographic, where they can actually share with the class in a way that's relevant to the kids, something that's kind of flashy and interesting. What is the data that our group got? And then what do we do with that data if we look at everyone's data together? So kids reach their conclusions a couple days after we do our sampling.
Because sometimes, like, when you're just reading from a book, you don't really think about how this is actually real life and this, how it actually works.
We're working through some question together, and we're discovering things as we go. And kids always bring with them knowledge. And very often it turns out that the kids teach me a lot, and we're all sort of learning together.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that. And thank you, Dr. Stiles.
My pleasure. I love it.
And so we've just learned about the interactive practice of scientific inquiry, which is about collecting data and gathering evidence and making decisions. Now we're going to learn about engineering design, which is a problem-solving process we use in technology and engineering education. Engineers use engineering design to solve problems. Engineers solve problems where scientists ask questions. Is this water, can I go swimming in this water? How do I make a float, you know, that I can go across the water? That would be a problem. Engineering design is a problem-solving process. Engineers are looking for a solution to a problem. So when you see engineering design, think about it's a problem-solving process. And there are many, many models of this engineering design process. For our session model, we've looked at all the different models, and we picked a 5-step model that identifies a problem, explores ideas related to solving a problem, plan and develop a solution, test and evaluate. That's where you can bring your science inquiry in if you want, and present the solution. This engineering design is a problem-solving process that promotes integrative STEM, creativity and innovation, critical and divergent thinking, hands-on, open-ended problem-solving and solving real-world problems, and communication and collaboration. Again, engineering design is a problem-solving process. Identify a problem or challenge. Have the students do it or the teacher can do it. Have them do some research on it. Explore ideas related to solving the problem. You've all heard of this idea of brainstorming. And as you explore ideas, consider the criteria and constraints. What are you limited to? How much time do you have? Next thing, you plan and develop a solution. For example, a model or a prototype. A prototype is typically an exact size working model. A model can be something smaller. It may not work, but a prototype works. Then you test and evaluate the solution. This is where you can use your scientific inquiry and investigation, if needed, to modify the solution. And then you present the solution, just like you do in scientific inquiry. How do you give students engineering design problems? We use something called engineering design challenges. So engineering design challenges let students apply the engineering design process. And if you look at an engineering design challenge, you'll typically see some type of a situation. You'll see a challenge. You'll see some criteria and constraints. You'll see some resources and evaluation. At a minimum, a teacher should give some type of situation and a challenge. Let me show you an example here. A store owner wants a free M&M dispenser. Challenge, develop an M&M candy dispenser. I think we all have had M&Ms before. So the situation, the store owner wants to give away free M&Ms. Develop this candy dispenser. This is one I've done before with some Thai teachers. Identify the problem. Explore ideas to solve the problem. Plan and develop a solution. Criteria, use only tool and material supplied. Constraints, you only have 30 minutes to build it. I provided the resources and the tools, and they work together in a team to plan and develop a solution. Test and evaluate the solution and present the solution. This is an engineering design challenge that I've given before, and there's two of the solutions. In engineering design, typically every solution is going to be a little bit different. Each team makes a different solution. There are many answers to solve a problem. And as you teach about engineering design, you connect science, technology, engineering, and math. The candy bag is technology, the sorting machines. Science, making a chocolate mixture so it doesn't melt in your hand. That's one of the sayings. The mathematics, you can start to do some statistics, measuring the size. How M&Ms are made. Let's watch this short video and think about how STEM is involved. Idea there. The STEM is really involved here in an engineering design challenge. The making of M&Ms involved a lot of STEM. You saw the robots being used. You saw the measuring. This is a lot of M&M challenges are on the internet if you're interested. Let's look at some more examples of engineering design challenges. This is one of my favorite ones. It's a Thai video here. The street is flooded. Develop a safe way to cross it. Oh, STEM wasn't involved in making this innovative project. Here's some of my design challenge ideas for you as we wrap this up here. A dangerous animal in a cage. Develop a safe feeder. A bike race. Develop a helmet. River flooded. Develop a bridge out of recycled materials. Raining. Develop an umbrella. Earthquake. Develop a warning system. A lot of design challenge ideas with this pandemic. Plastic recycling has kind of been put on the back burner, but there's so much that can be done in plastic recycling, disaster related, or musical instruments. Have students at home in a digital or virtual world make an instrument and share it. Another design challenge idea I've actually done with teachers. A person is going on a road trip of 3 hours and need to keep their medicine cold. They don't have a cooler. In small groups, develop a cooler that keeps ice for a minimum of 3 hours. Another design challenge idea we did a few weeks ago. You're on a camping trip in the woods. You're hungry for some warm food. Challenge is use the engineering design process to build a small-scale prototype of a mini solar oven. You can see some of them done there below. And then use science investigation to measure the mini solar oven's ability to heat. I did it at my house. It was at 10 C. It started, and I got it up to 65 C. And the outside temperature is only 10 C. Students are going to learn a lot with an engineering design challenge. They're going to learn the science investigation. They're going to learn how to use the engineering design process, how to build a model or prototype. They're going to learn about STEM concepts and contents, creativity and innovation, exploring complex systems. They're going to learn about research and information, hands-on skills, critical thinking, problem solving, decision making, using tools and materials. Engineering design challenge offers a lot, and teamwork. They offer a lot here. Just before our conclusion here, I want to show you, think about the STEM in here. I think you'll enjoy this video. Here's about a Thai solar cooking chicken. Think about the STEM.
ทางรถไฟมาพอดีตอนนี้กระจกกับรถที่ขึ้นตรงนี้นะฮะไปกระทบกระจกรถหน้ารถอ่ะนะหน้ารถตอนนี้ผมเดินอยู่ตรงนั้นอ่ะ มี8อาทิตย์มันก็โดนตัวผมนะฮะนี่หมาหลายคันก็วุ๊บวุ๊บร้อนร้อนร้อนร้อนนะฮะสำคัญก็ร้อนมากนี่ผมว่าเอ๊ะมันร้อนแบบนี้มันกระจกเงามันสะท้อนจากโดนที่นี่เราดัดแปลงออกมาเป็นพลังงานมันน่าจะใช้ได้นะช่วงนั้นน่ะไอ้พลังงานมันเริ่มแพงขึ้นเงี้ยเช่นน้ำมันก๊าซนี่แล้วก็ไอ้ป่าไม้เมืองไทยนี่ก็จะหมดแล้วนะฮะว่าเอ๊ะถ้าเราใช้พลังงานแสงอาทิตย์ขึ้นมานี่มันจะประหยัดได้เยอะนะฮะจะคิดขึ้นมาว่าเออใช้ได้นะครับแล้วมันลดมลพิษอ่ะมันจะไม่มีฟันไฟฮะแล้วไม่ก่อมลพิษหรือมลภาวะนะครับแล้วไอ้นี่มันจะสะอาดนะฮะถ้าย่างโดยทานี่ไอ้พวกขมเหลวอะไรมันจะเกาะตามนี้หมดเลยนะฮะกินแล้วอันตรายนะครับ
Well, I hope you enjoyed that video. I mean, there's a lot of STEM involved in there. An engineering design challenge to cook chicken. Lots of internet, on the internet, lots of design challenge ideas for you teachers out there. So let's conclude here. Just a couple slides. Teaching STEM requires that instructors understand that it is a teaching and learning approach that promotes the integration of the subject areas. Teaching STEM requires that instructors understand that they can incorporate the interactive strategies of scientific inquiry and engineering design into their real and virtual classrooms. And I'd like to end here on a quote from a winner of the 2009 Nobel Prize. And Elizabeth said, I didn't want to just know the names of things. I remember really wanting to know how it all worked. And that was me as a kid. I wanted to know how it worked. So I want to say thank you. And I do believe we have a few times for questions here. I also want to remind you that we're developing a STEM course for the STEMIO STEM Ed Center. And you can look at stemiostemed.org and you can learn about this STEM course that's being developed for teachers to learn about STEM. And I will post my presentation here. And I've got a lot of good references if you need the references and links to the videos and links to our STEM standards. So with that, I say thank you. I think we do have a few minutes for questions, John.
We do have a few. Ed, why don't you go ahead and post those on the handouts? And because we had many requests for resources, many, many good questions here. A few of them that I want to call out here. Some people wanted to know where can they get information about really good resources for STEM teaching, especially in science and mathematics. And I replied to one of them. There are many great resources on the internet for outstanding activities. You don't have to think them up yourself. There's many of them there. One of the critical things is, and people asked about the capstone projects in their schools, and I think in the Philippines is where they require these projects. I taught the International Baccalaureate biology course, which is similar. They didn't call it capstone, but it was a very similar thing, in which students developed their own projects at the end of the term or end of the year, using knowledge from various disciplines, and they work together on those. And there are lots of really good, I just did a quick internet search under capstone projects. There are lots of them, there are scores of them. As far as interesting activities that will motivate students, that was asked also, there I have found, and I think Ed will agree with me, that if you use interactive hands-on activities, every activity will be interesting to the student. Not all of them are easily done with hands-on. But when you find, and you can't, you don't have to do this all the time, the STEM projects and the engineering design and the science inquiry. But when you do, using interesting activities, starting with a question that student, and you saw in the video that the teacher used, simple question about the stream outside their school. there's many things. So you can find these on the internet. We, as Ed has said, we have resources on this slideshow that will be shared with you. One last comment, because I know our time is just about up. Someone asked about safety supervision during the pandemic, and that's a really good question. Obviously, you try not to have students use materials that are dangerous or that could cause harm. And with primary and middle school students especially, you have to be very careful. And sometimes requires parent supervision or parent permission. I'm sorry, I guess that's all the time we have, Tristan. I'm sorry I can't spend more time, but I have put our email addresses on there. If you have questions, you can email both of us, and we'll be glad to answer your questions. Thank you all for your attention. I hope this very short presentation has encouraged you to try out these methodologies, and we'll be happy to answer any questions by email.
Yeah, and I put a PDF of part one and part two of the slideshow, so they can get a PDF and look at it, and great. Have all the information there.
All right. Awesome. Well, thank you so much again, Dr. Stiles and Dr. Reeve. Interesting ideas on redefining STEM education, advantages and challenges of applying scientific inquiry in class and using engineering design as a pedagogy. So hopefully we'll have you again in the next CIMEO Congress. Also, I thank our participants for joining us in this session, and I will see you around in the other sessions. Thank you very much, and good day, everyone.
Thank you all. Thank you, Tristan.
Thank you.
Take care. Good luck with your presentations. Good luck with your activities.
We go backstage.
Yeah.